Jeff, someone forgot to lock the doors. Is it your fault? Yeah, we'll blame Jeff. We blame Jeff for everything. Christ is risen. Christ is risen. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Great to see you on this Easter Sunday. Number of announcements to share with you. First of all, Hoops for Haiti update. We are literally $35 short of $6,000 for Hoops for Haiti. So if you want to write a check for $35, that'd be great. If we get a number of checks for $35, we'll be well over $6,000. Every single penny of the money we raise goes toward the Haitian Timon Foundation. There are seven congregations participating in this friendly competition, and we think that when all is said and done, we will have raised about $50,000 for the Haitian Timon Foundation. So thank you. If you were up late last night, what a finish! 93-90 on an improbable 50-foot shot by Suggs of Gonzaga. So if you still have Gonzaga in your brackets, you are lucky, but it was a great, great game. Rise and shine today at 10:15. Jeff, are we still collecting stuff for the young adult packages? Yes, we are. And so there are donations we're looking for. You can find the list in the April newsletter. And we're looking to reach out to our young adults who graduated high school through age 26. If you're planning to make an offering this morning, we have two plates at the back of the sanctuary and also two plates at the front if you'd like to bring it with you as you come forward to receive communion. Speaking of communion, this morning you will be ushered forward to receive the bread by an usher. You'll receive the bread from me. We're going to do this side first, that side next. I will also have gluten-free wafers on the tables on either side of me. And then after you've received the bread, you'll fan off to receive the wine in a small individual glass, and then you can place the empty in the basket as you make your way back to your seat. If you're not comfortable with communing that way, but please know I'll be wearing a mask and gloves, same with the communion assistant. But if you're more comfortable, you can grab one of the miracle meals, come forward, take it with you back to your seat, and you can commune that way. If you are a guest with us this morning, first of all, thank you for spending a part of your Easter Sunday with us. We're grateful for your presence. And if you'd like to, we'd love for you to visit the welcome desk on the way out. We have a gift bag that we would like to share with you. And again, thank you so much for being here today. There are beautiful flowers in the gathering space and also the chancel area, as well as incredible lit candles, a wonderful way to celebrate Easter. If you purchased a flower, please leave it here until after 11 o'clock so we have full and beautiful flowers throughout the morning. Easter Sunday is a day of celebration. Easter Sunday is a day of surprises. Easter Sunday is a day when we get to do things that we didn't necessarily imagine that we could. This morning you are invited to sing out, if you wish, as we stand. It's Easter Sunday. It doesn't make sense to be quiet behind masks. We do ask you to keep on your masks, please, but we invite you to belt it out, if you wish, on this Easter Sunday as we celebrate the good news of our Lord's resurrection. Please stand as we sing.
Our triumphant holy day,
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Pray. Creator of life, in raising Christ Jesus up through, out of, and beyond the chains of death, you opened for us the way to eternal and abundant life. May our alleluias on this day float high above the ceiling of what we think we know and transcend to the heaven of what we believe and thus live. Raise us up, renew our lives, resurrect our dreams. Through Jesus Christ, our living Savior. Amen. 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 Please be seated.
A reading from Acts of the Apostles. Then Peter began to speak to them. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee, after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. How he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Gospel according to Mark, the 16th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go and anoint him. Very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
It's good to be back. It's good to celebrate. It's good to have a glorious day. It's good to smell the Easter flowers. It's good to see the candles lit. It's good to see God's people gathered together on this Easter Sunday. If you've been here on Easter before, you know that I'd like to have a little bit of fun because this is a day of joy, it's a day of celebration, and I like to think that Easter is also a day when we can have fun, knowing that life has been given to us. So this morning what we're going to do, and some of you know the drill, some of you don't, so listen carefully. We're going to do this three times, okay? We're going to start with this side, you're going to raise the roof with Christ is risen. And then this side, he is risen indeed. And then together, instead of churchy hallelujah, we're going to say, "All right." All right, we're going to do this three times. You got to be ready. If you don't start strong, we'll go back and try it again, okay? All right. You got excited about basketball yesterday, if you are a basketball fan. Certainly you can get more excited about the resurrection of Jesus. It's a great day, okay? Christ is risen, he is risen indeed, then together, all right, three times, all right? Here we go, ready? Christ is risen, he is risen indeed, all right. Christ is risen, he is risen indeed, all right. Christ is risen, he is risen indeed, all right. All right, thank you. I know my older sister, who is pretty traditional about worship, is watching this morning. Brenda, glad you're here, and hope that you and we enjoy this incredible day. It was the day that changed everything. It's important to say that because there are a lot of people who think that Jesus was a great teacher. There are a lot of people who think that Jesus was even a great healer. There are a lot of people that thought that Jesus was a man full of wisdom, but that when Friday came and the cross came and death came and the tomb came and the stone came, that it was all over, that he was a good guy, that it was good that he had been there, that he had helped us figure out some things about life, all of which was true. But today, the day the tomb is empty, is the day that changes everything, which means it changes our lives. It changes everything about who we are. It changes everything about how we see the world. This passage from the Gospel of Mark is pretty interesting. Toward the end of today's passage, the young man dressed in white says, "Go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you." It's like this young man wants to be sure that Peter knows he is still a part of the group, even though he has denied Jesus not once, not twice, but three times, and that was not all right, that he was still a part of the gang. So tell Peter that he is a part of it. We, I think, can be in that position of Peter sometimes. We wonder if we can be a, part of the gang because all of the mistakes that we've made. But the young man says, go tell the disciples. And Peter, you can fill in your name and fill in the blank. So Mark tells us they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. That is how the Gospel of Mark ends. Now, if you pull out your Bible, you might see verses 9 to 20, which is the happier ending of the Gospel of Mark, but not a part of the original story. Why does that matter? Because Mark chooses to end this story with the women fleeing from the tomb, and they didn't say anything to anybody because they were afraid. So why do you think they were afraid? Were they afraid because they anticipated that there would be a stone that had to be rolled away and that there would be a rotting corpse that needed to be anointed for burial? Did they run in fear because they knew it was true and they didn't anticipate that it was going to be true? They were so afraid that they couldn't even bring words to their lips, according to Mark. They were so overwhelmed, and so it's really a story with an unhappy ending. There is no proclamation of the gospel. There is only, oh my God, what is happening here? And they run, and they are afraid, and they say nothing to anyone. Or is this a story with an unhappy ending? Is that all there is? Is there just fear and trembling and being overwhelmed and not saying anything about it for whatever reason? Is it an unhappy ending or is it? Verse 8, the Gospel of Mark, is where the story begins. It's not where the story ends. It is the story that begins. Because if Jesus is on the loose, it means that everything has changed, whether we announce it or not. Because it's up to God to make the change. Whether we say a word about it, God has changed everything, and Jesus is on the loose, and maybe that should be enough to make us fearful. Because if everything has changed, that means that God wants us, in some ways, to change the way we live to reflect resurrection life. I love the idea of the resurrection as the fulfillment of God's dream. God has this dream for the world. God has this dream for us. God has this dream that through all of the suffering, all of the pain, all of the loneliness, all of the difficulties that we all experience, that somehow God's dream is big enough to heal all of it. God's dream is big enough to make things new that we think would never be new again. The resurrection is God's dream fulfilled for us, for the world, for even all of creation. God's dream fulfilled says that everything Jesus taught and did is vindicated. In other words, his death on the cross and his place in the tomb and the stone in front of the tomb do not have the final word. Everything that Jesus said and taught is vindicated by God. He is more than just a good guy. He is more than just a great teacher. He is more than someone who liked to hang out with the likes of us for meals. He is more than that. He is the risen one. He is the one who came out of the tomb and whose resurrection caused such an uproar that the women were overwhelmed to the point that they didn't even know what to say. But God was changing things. Jesus was vindicated. Now, for some people, God's dream is really more of a nightmare, because God's dream is about what Jesus called the kingdom of God. God's dream is about a table where there are places for everybody, even you, even me. God's dream is what we see Jesus doing, hanging out with people who are on the edge of things, hanging out with people who were rejected by the mainstream, rejected by the respectable, And so God's dream can sometimes be a nightmare for us because if we're honest, we're not really interested in hanging out with certain people. We're not really interested in reaching out to feed the poor. We're not really interested in getting outside of our comfort zone for the sake of the world, for the sake of fulfilling God's dream. And so for some of us, God's dream is a nightmare because we would rather have no change in our lives. We would rather just be able to be comfortable, to sit still, to live life the way that we want to go into our house, into the garage, close the garage door, shut out the rest of the world. And God is all about anything as different than that as you could imagine. So how do you see God's dream? Is it a nightmare? Would you rather kind of sit where you are and not introduce any kind of change into your life? The resurrection changes everything, including us. So the question that for me comes out of today's gospel is, what are you afraid of? What are the things that you're afraid of? Who are the people that you are afraid of? What are the things that you see that you are afraid of? We all have our fears, and sometimes our fears take us to a place that can paralyze us. Our fears can take us to a place that we can't see the new thing that God is doing. Our fears can take us to a place where we're not able to imagine God's dream. We're not able to imagine what God is already doing. And maybe we're afraid of it because we don't think we're up to it. We don't think we're up to participating in it. So what are the things that you're afraid of? They're the things that hold you down, the things that hold me down, the things that hold us down from participating in this great new work that God is doing in the resurrection. Easter faith is about change. And for those of you who are, this is kind of inside humor for just a moment, so bear with me, but when we think about change and we think about, let's say, traditional Lutheran people, there might be this response. Back in my day, we sang Lutheran hymns in the Lutheran church. Some of you are laughing. Some of you have no idea, and I apologize. This is just for a minute. Why do we want to change? What are these new hymns? Or this. You know you're Lutheran when you greet a visitor with, "Welcome, you're in my seat." What are you afraid of? What don't you want to have change? Anyway, change is not always a welcome thing. Our response might be, "No, thank you. I'm happy with things just as they are. I'm happy with things, and I wish we could go back to 1955 again." But instead, we're in 2021. Everything has changed. Nothing is the way it used to be. No, thank you. I'm not interested in change. Marcus Borg says this, "Christianity's goal is not escape from this world. It loves this world and seeks to change it for the better." So the resurrection does not remove us and take us to some far-off place. The resurrection of Jesus plants us firmly on the soil of this planet so that we can be a part of changing it for good, so that we can be a part of loving it for the good. It's not beam me up because there is no intelligent life on this planet. It's right here. Jesus goes to Galilee. He goes back home on this earth to keep making change as the resurrected Christ. So Easter's not about escaping. And if you're somebody who comes to the church and you think, you know, I can't get into that because Christians are just about trying to escape suffering. Christians are about trying to escape this world. That's not what Christians are about at all. I don't know what you've heard, but that's not the message of Jesus. So if you are a person, I don't care where you come from. I don't care about your faith. I don't care if you believe anything or not. But God can and will use you in this place to work for good. And you may not want to acknowledge it as God, that's okay, but God will be working through you and through all of us. Resurrection faith is also curious. Resurrection faith wonders about things. We have a term that we've been using around here. We call it traditioned innovation. So we love our tradition. We do. We love our Lutheran hymns, if you're a Lutheran. We love the things that have gotten us to this place, but we're also curious. Okay, what does it mean that Jesus is risen from the dead, and what does that mean for the future? Maybe we want to ask some questions. Maybe things are not the way they were before, and that's a good thing because resurrection moves us forward. A curious faith. Rob Bell says this, times change. God doesn't, but times do. We learn and grow, and the world around us shifts. And the Christian faith is alive only when it is listening, paying attention, morphing, changing as a part of this new life, and innovating as we think about the new things that God is doing in our lives. Letting go of whatever has gotten in the way of Jesus and embracing whatever will help us be more and more the people God wants us to be. Morphing, innovating, curiosity. What is the new thing that God is doing in our congregation and in the world today? I love this. This is from the United Church of Christ. God is still speaking. Never place a period where God has placed a comma. That's resurrection faith. That's a resurrection God who continues to speak, who continues to speak to us, who continues to say a word about how we might continue to morph and change and grow as disciples of Jesus. Resurrection faith, for me, is about embracing diversity, which means that we look around our community and we look around our congregation and we look around our families and we look around the people that we go to school with and that we work with, and we try to find a way to say, okay, resurrection faith calls me to appreciate all of these different folks, to see in them God's image, regardless of ethnicity, regardless of sexual orientation, regardless of class or status or income or whatever. When I look at you and when I look at the world, I see beautiful people. Even Dave Zimmer, I see a beautiful man there. And that's the kind of vision that God wants us to have, to appreciate and to celebrate diversity as a sign of life. After all, Jesus has been raised from the dead for all, and all means all. Everyone at the table, everyone participating in this great and glorious news. Friends, I hope that you might be inspired by this Easter faith to be open to how God's working in your life. Even if you don't believe in God, take a look, give it a try, because God is at work. All are welcome with Jesus, and all means all, and all means you and your neighbor. Amen.
Is the
Let us affirm our faith. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of the one God, maker and sustainer of earth and sky. Born of Mary's womb, faithful of God, Jesus healed the sick, served the poor, and proclaimed heaven on earth. Condemned by the religious, crucified by the state, he died and rose to life everlasting. Jesus blessed the disciples with his Holy Spirit and went to the north, east and west, north and south. Give ourselves to Jesus and to one another as siblings in Christ, guided by God's Spirit. Amen. Alive in the risen Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit, we bring our prayers before God, who promises to hear us and answer in steadfast love. Almighty and ever-living God, on this, the most wonderful day of the year, we shout with joy and thanks that you shared your Son with us. Not only that he paid the price for our transgressions so that we may live forgiven and on a path to everlasting relation with you, but also that he taught us how to live each day on earth in praise to you and in service to all our neighbors. Help us wake each day in recognition that he has risen and that he has given us another day that we may show our love and service to those in need. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we offer thanks that we are able to see so many of your followers today in this building we call Epiphany. These halls have been empty so long as we have traversed this epidemic. Thank you for walking at our side during those times we have been unable to be with those we love and miss. Thank you for providing tireless healthcare workers who ushered many back to health and who offered comfort to the families of those who were lost. Thank you for the scientist you sent to us to create a vaccine that gives us hope that the end is near. But please, Lord, give us all patience so as not to declare victory won while the disease is still among us. Help us to follow the guidance of our leaders until we can fully return to the world we used to know. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, the resurrection of your Son to new life is echoed by the springtime return of life in our world. The color of the forsythian daffodils and actual green in the grass emphasize to us the wonder of the world you created and entrusted to our care. Keep us ever focused on the ways we can help preserve your creation for generations to come. But the spring isn't only about beauty. Once again, devastating tornadoes have struck the South and record floods have drenched Nashville. We ask you to embrace all those suffering from these weather events and show us ways to offer assistance. Lord, in your mercy. God of peace, with mass shootings and killings in Atlanta, Boulder, Orange, California, and even at the steps of our national capital, with evidence of abuses toward Asian Americans across our nation, and with reminders of abuses to our African American brothers in the trial in Minneapolis, we continue to demonstrate that we humans can really mess up the world you have allowed us to live in. We ask you to amplify in us the power of love and forgiveness, that it may overwhelm the forces of hatred and violence. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray you shower the joy of Easter not only on this congregation at Epiphany, but to those other congregations we serve in Brotherhood, Holy Trinity Episcopal Church in Bel Air, Ohio, First English Lutheran Church in Inner City, Columbus, and our Lutheran Fellowship in Jacmel, Haiti. We pray your healing hand for Kim Johnson and for others we lift to you silently from our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. In the hope of new life in Christ, we raise our prayers to you, trusting in your never-ending goodness and mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. In the Gospel of John, Jesus entered a room where the disciples were hiding because they were afraid, and he said, "Peace be with you." And their lives were changed because of that greeting. And so as we gather this morning, as resurrection people, we share a sign of God's peace. May the peace of the risen Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Please be seated. Please stand.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth, and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed are you, O God of the universe. Your mercy is everlasting, and your faithfulness endures from age to age. Praise to you for creating the heavens and the earth. Praise to you for saving the earth from the waters of the flood. Praise to you for bringing the Israelites safely through the sea. Praise to you for leading your people through the land to the promise of milk and honey. Praise to you for the words and deeds of Jesus, your anointed one. Praise to you for the death and resurrection of Jesus. Praise to you for your Spirit poured out on us and all nations. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all of them to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Spirit of the resurrection, we pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated.
Thank you. Thank you.
Please stand. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the gifts of the bread and wine that we have shared strengthen us and unite us in bonds of love and peace. Amen.
Let us pray. Wellspring of joy, through this meal you have put gladness in our hearts. Satisfy the hunger still around us and send us as joyful witnesses that your love may bring joy to the hearts of all people. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, amen.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Those are about the best words of encouragement I can give you. Have a great week.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.